70 is picked as a subject for careful study because in a way it's so typical. Has a liquid-liquid extraction and a blowdown and an internal standard calibration. But on another level, the 8270 is perhaps the most sophisticated analysis there is. A lot of that sophistication relates to the quality control considerations. The quality control percolates through absolutely every single corner of the analysis. Every time the analyst does anything, it is according to the EPA specifications. The EPA is looking over absolutely everything. It's hard to separate the quality control considerations from everything else, but I want to take one look at it right now directly. Let's start with this example. A fairly common contaminant is 2-methyl naphthalene. We have a hit for 2-methyl naphthalene. It comes in at 23.4 minutes, and it's 37 parts per billion. 2-methyl naphthalene. We have a mass spectral match for 2-methyl naphthalene, and it comes in where we expect to see it at 23.4 minutes. Well, the nature of mass spec is that, and the nature of the GC mass spec is that if you have a hit and you have a spectral match and you have a retention time fit, it's silly to question whether it's 2-methyl naphthalene. You got a hit for 2-methyl naphthalene, you got 2-methyl naphthalene. But I think you can question where it came from. You say, well, where could it have come from? It could have come from a lot of places. It could have come from the methylene chloride. The glassware could have been dirty. The autosampler vials could have been dirty. The autosampler itself, the rinse cycle could have been contaminated. The GC will sometimes burp things out. I mean, it's not an easy question. Where did it come from? One of the first steps in anything in analytical chemistry is that you run a blank, a 000 blank, zero everything. The prep blank uses the same glassware that's been treated in the same way. In this case, it comes out of a furnace. Uses the same methylene chloride out of the same jug, you know, same beaker, same pouring system, same everything. It uses the same autosampler vials, the same Ebendorf pipette to move it. It uses the same GC autosampler, the same injection system. And if your prep blank comes out clean, then you can be, I would say there's no 100% certainty on this, but if your prep blank is coming out clean, you can be pretty sure, or let me back up a little bit, you can be very, very, very sure that the 2-methyl naphthalene came from the sample. That's the, I'd say, the first quality control step, and that applies to everything in analytical chemistry. Everything has a zero blank. Let's take a look at another area. Let's say you have a sample, comes from the Walmart site, and it comes up with no, it's clean. The soil or the water comes up clean. How do you know that the mass spec didn't stop running? Maybe the quadrupole fried and nothing happened. Maybe the injection didn't work. Maybe the extraction didn't work. There's a lot of steps. A lot of things that can go wrong. You get zero. Well, that's nice. There's nothing on it. This works out for everybody. You got to know for sure that that analysis worked the way you think it did. There's a trick which is used in the environmental business, and I have a very broad experience in analytical chemistry. I've never seen this anywhere else. The first thing that is done to it is spiked with compounds. They're sort of like internal standards. They duplicate the behavior of the analytes. They're not found in nature. Mass spectroscopy is cool because if you want something like that, you can use stable isotopes. They're typically stable isotopes. Stable isotopes are not found in nature, and you can, as you should know, an isotope has a different mass, but it doesn't really have a different chemical characteristic. And the mass spectroscopy is the most incredibly powerful tool. It will separate the isotopes. The surrogates, they're called surrogates. You say, well, surrogates. I remember the first time I heard that word, I thought, surrogates, that's a weird name. Surrogates? Where does that come from? Whatever. But they call them surrogates. The surrogates come especially in the acid category, because that's a category of analyte, and the base, which is another category of analytes. But there are, some of them are amines, some of them are phenols, some of them are carboxylic acids. Several of them are big polyaromatic hydrocarbons. They follow the range of the analytes. And if your blank sample shows the surrogates, then you can be sure that the extraction worked the way you think it did. You can be sure the injection worked. You can be sure the analysis worked the way you think it did. There are six surrogates. Another thing, we'll get to this later, is that there are six internal standards. You got a sample, it runs, it has no, it's clean. That chromatogram has 12 peaks. There's 12 peaks that tell you that the analysis worked the way you think it did. The environmental consultants sent a sample to the laboratory requesting an 8270. They get results back that say that they have 37 parts per billion 2-methyl naphthalene. So what kind of confidence do the environmental consultants have that this is correct? If it's over 50, then it goes into a new category, and they're going to have to look at it and consider doing a cleanup. So there's a lot of difference between 37 parts per billion and 67 parts per billion. The EPA can be confident of the results because the 8270 has very specific quality control constraints related to the quantitation. I want to talk back up just a little bit about how the quantitation works. Partly because I think it's interesting and it's very much part of the quality control story. The method for the 8270 consists of 70 peaks, which are identified in the method. Those 70 peaks are located to their approximate location on the chromatogram. There are six internal standards. Similarly, they're located, named and located on the chromatogram. The method requires 5 calibration points. They're at 20, 50, 80, 120, and 160. So the operator makes a 120, makes a 20 standard. The 20 standard is 20 of everything, including the surrogates. He makes another one at 50, another one at 80, another one at 120, and another one at 160. These 5 samples are analyzed. Okay, they're analyzed as standards. Let's pick one fairly narrow area. Let's pick phenol. It's easy to pronounce. The phenol gives a response factor on the 20 standard of 1.4. So that means that the 20 standard comes in at 1.4. The 1.4 refers to the slope of the line, okay? And then the phenol at 50 gives the same point, basically the same point. The phenol at, let's look at it over here again, gives a 1.46, so it's just a little bit higher at the 80. Just a little bit higher at the 80. So every analyte is treated in this way. The software looks at every analyte and says, what is the slope of the line? Based upon the response factor. It's an internal standard response factor, but at this point it doesn't particularly matter. What's the response versus the quantitation? Gives them the slope of the line. The slope of the line should be the same. The response factor should be the same. Analysis produces errors, and they don't come out perfectly. The phenol, for example, if we look just at this point right here, the phenol gives us a 1.4, 1.4, 1.46, 1.35, 1.343, and 1.393. So the line looks pretty good. It's incredible to think about it, but the software does this for every single point, for every single analyte. So there's 70 of these, actually more, for the 20. There's like 70 or more for the 50. The software just does this automatically. The computer's amazing. Then the operator goes to a different section of the software and says, okay, put all this together and come up with a conclusion for me. The sheet is a little bit dated, but I think it's fine. We have the 20. This is one injection. This is an injection. This is an injection. This is an injection. So these are all the slopes for all the 20s. These are all the slopes for the 50s. These are all the slopes for the 80s and the 120s and the 160s. This column is the average slope. So that's like saying that's the best slope we can do is just average the slopes. It could have been done other ways, but this is the way they did it. This is the way the EPA specifies it. And then this is the average, the percent relative standard deviation. Again, this is defined by the EPA. I don't think as scientists, I don't think we need to worry too much about why they do things, but this is the way the EPA has defined it. Okay, so quality control. The quality control is mostly related to this chart. The EPA knows where the weak links are in the analysis. Some compounds aren't very stable. Some compounds react in the injector. Some compounds react with other compounds in the mixture and are unstable. And they know where those weak links are. And they go to the weak links and they say, if the pentachlorophenol has a response factor above a certain point, and the dienethyl phthalate has a response factor above a certain point, and if the quality of the line for the benzoic acid meets a certain spec, then the analysis is good. So this is one of the very first things for quality control, is that the EPA looks at the initial calibration and they make sure that everything's okay. This is one of the very first things they do. Let's right now look at one last quality control aspect, partly because I think it's pretty cool. The mass spectrometer is an absolutely incredibly powerful piece of instrumentation. We get a hit for 2-methyl naphthalene. It has a peak at 142 and a peak at 115. How do we know these peaks are in the right place? I think the credit goes to the people that designed the instrument. It's just the mass spectrometer is incredibly powerful, and I think it's a credit to the people that designed and built it. The way it works is this. Built into the mass spec is a vial of PFTBA, perfluorotributylamine. The perfluorotributylamine is a liquid, but it vaporizes pretty quickly. As a software function, the operator opens a valve, the PFTBA goes into the vacuum system and becomes ionized. The PFTBA fragments, like all things do, in a very predictable fashion. And then the tune is, as a software function, like as a mouse move, hit tune. That's it. And the instrument is tuned. Which is to say that the software knows where to find the peaks, knows how to assign them. This is all part of the software. It's easy. The calibration of the mass assignments is the same as any other calibration technique in chemistry. The PFTBA is the standard. The control is DFTPP, which is triphenylphosphine, something like that. The DFTPP is injected into the instrument and goes through the gas chromatograph. It comes out as a peak, like other peaks. From that peak, the operator gets a scan, and then as a right-click function, The scan is compared against the DFTPP criteria. This is a software function. It's complicated, but the instrument has the software to take care of this. The DFTPP criteria says, first of all, is the resolution of the masses as good as it needs to be? And second of all, is the linearity of the assignments proper? Let's look at mass 68 and mass 70. Mass 69 is a big peak. There shouldn't be any mass 68, and there shouldn't be any mass 70, or not very much. Part of the criteria is that they want to see the mass of 68 to be less than 2% of 69. And they want to see 70 to be less than 2% of 69. So they're saying, for example, they don't want the 69 to be leaking into the 68 or into the 70 very much. So it's like, is the resolution good enough to meet the 8270 standards? A second example is mass 198 has to be greater than 50% of 442. They're saying, is the linearity across the board good enough to meet the 8270 standards? The EPA knows where the problems are going to be, and they know how to evaluate it. It's a very sophisticated test. I worked as a mass spec operator for many years. Passing the DFTPP criteria can be a problem. That's a different story. Chemistry is very abstract, and there's nothing really that can be done about that. There's no way to not make it abstract. It's abstract, and that's the way it is. The way we deal with this is we go at the same conclusions from different places. And if we go in the same direction, or if we arrive at the same point from two different abstract positions, then we can make a confident assumption that what we're saying is correct. This applies across the board to analytical chemistry and even across the board to chemistry.